Welcome. Did that work?
There we go.
Good morning. Good morning. All right. I've got my mic on. Can you all hear me? Oh, hey, there it is. Excellent. Good morning. Welcome to St. James Lutheran Church on this Palm Sunday. So glad to have you all here. This is awesome. It's always such an exciting time. My name is Pastor Amy. If you are visiting, welcome. I'd love to meet you after worship in the narthex here. We begin Holy Week today, tracing the story of Jesus' triumphal entrance into Jerusalem. We'll experience Jesus' radical servant love on Maundy Thursday. In evening worship at 7 p.m., we'll also have our Good Friday service on Friday, 7 p.m., and we remember Jesus' triumph over the grave on Easter Sunday at 10 a.m. All are invited and encouraged to come experience the story of the most holy and meaningful week of the church year. Can you all hear me okay? Excellent. Good. We have thoroughly enjoyed having snacks and treats after worship each week, and we'd like to continue doing this. There is a sign-up sheet on the kiosk right there to sign up to bring treats for the months of April and May. If you've been looking for a way to get involved, this is a great step. All will receive a nail for Good Friday after worship today on your way out. The plan is to bring it back to worship on Good Friday, where you'll have the option to pound the nail into the cross. And on Easter Sunday, there will be fresh flowers that will weave into the nails pounded into the cross on Good Friday. Before we begin our worship service with our processional, we'll learn a new song this morning for our procession. It's called Pave the Way with Branches. Does everyone have a bulletin? Do you need anything? All right, very good. And it is found in your bulletin, but I invite you to listen to Mark Taylor as he teaches us the simple song, and we hope that you can walk into the sanctuary listening and singing along without using your bulletin, if at all possible. We'll process into this song, and then when we're all in our places, we'll transition to singing the beloved hymn, All Glory, Laud, and Honor, which is also in your bulletin. So please follow along the way of Jesus, trusting his leadership, as well as Mark Taylor.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. There was a time when I would care.
Good. Thank you. At this time, we'll begin our worship service in a Palm Sunday greeting and the blessing of the palms before we process into worship. Also, all are invited to take your palms home and display them in your homes for the year. You'll be invited to bring them back to worship for the creation of the ashes for next year. There are a little different palms this year than we've had in the past, but they make lovely crosses if you'd like to take them home and make a cross as well. I invite you all to prepare your hearts and minds for worship today. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. We praise you, O God, for redeeming the world through our Son, Jesus, through our Savior, Jesus Christ. Today he entered the holy city in triumph and was proclaimed Messiah and King by those who spread garments and branches along his way. Bless these branches and those who carry them. Grant us grace to follow our Lord in the way of the cross, so that joined to his death and resurrection, we enter into life with you, through the same Jesus Christ who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us go forth in peace. In the name of Christ, amen. Pave the way with branches. Jesus is coming. Hosanna. Jesus is coming.
Jesus is coming. Hosanna. Jesus is coming. Hosanna. To the praise of peace. Hosanna. Jesus is coming. Hosanna. To the praise.
Let us pray. Everlasting God, in your endless love for the human race, you sent our Lord Jesus Christ to take on our nature and to suffer death on the cross. In your mercy, enable us to share in his obedience to your will and in the glorious victory of his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. Any children that are here are welcome to come forward for a children's sermon. Hi, sweetheart. Hi, Charlie. Here, baby. You want to sit on this side? You can, yeah. Hi, good morning, good morning. Welcome. What do you guys think of this Palm Sunday thing, huh? You've done this before, right? Yeah. 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 Did you like following in the line, in the procession? How was that? How was that to be a part of that? What do you think? It was fun? Yeah. It was fun. It's kind of like a parade, right? And you're in a parade. Yeah. Yeah, you were in a parade with the Cub Scouts? Very cool. So today, the person that leads this parade is Jesus. Do you guys ever go somewhere and you're like, not sure where to go, right? Yeah, sometimes you have to look for a sign, like, oh, that's where the bathroom is, or oh, that's where we need to go for this class, or that kind of thing. Yeah, today, we get to follow Jesus, and we know exactly where we're going when we follow Jesus. Because actually, there was another parade on the other side of town that was like a Roman parade. You'll hear more about that in the sermon today. And so there was a choice for the people. They could go this way or they could go that way. And today we get to follow Jesus. So it's very exciting. We have, right now we're in Holy Week, and we will have Maundy Thursday, which means commandment on Thursday, and we'll have Good Friday. And somebody asked, why is it Good Friday if it's the day that Jesus died?
Yeah,
you were asking that, weren't you, Charlie? Yeah. And actually, it's the day that Jesus gives up his life for us. And then the next time that we gather on Sunday, we will have Easter. And we'll celebrate Jesus' resurrection, which means he comes back. And he is back with us to show us the way forward. So let us say a prayer today, okay? Dear God, thank you for coming to Jerusalem. Thank you for showing us the way to follow you. Help us to always follow you and trust you to lead us all our days. Amen. All right, thank you guys so much. You can go sit back. Oh, don't forget this. We got one piece of here. Okay. That's all right. Yep.
The first reading is from Isaiah. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear, to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious, I did not turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me, therefore I have not been disgraced. Therefore I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. Is it the Lord God who helps me? Who will declare me guilty? The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
The second reading is from Philippians. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father, the word of the Lord.
Holy Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it to me. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this: 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here immediately.'" They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. Here it is. Grace to you and peace from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Today is Palm Sunday. We started our worship with a symbolic procession into the sanctuary, waving our palms and singing, "Pave the way with branches." We stand on the threshold of Holy Week today, readying ourselves for the trials and triumphs of Jesus' journey. We anticipate the Last Supper, Jesus washing the disciples' feet, the pounding of the nails, the tomb, and fresh flowers woven amongst the stark iron on Easter Sunday. There's so much more to come, but first, we have to find our way into Jerusalem with Jesus today. If we do a close reading of this processional gospel, it's a pretty absurd story, and one that requires trust on the part of the disciples and the locals. Jesus essentially asked the disciples to borrow a young donkey from someone in the nearby village. The disciples do as they're asked and tell the bystanders, "The Lord needs it." Lord can be translated as God or the owner. Both are true in this instance. Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem consists of people shouting in front of him and behind him, laying branches and cloaks down in front of Jesus riding in on a little donkey. There's not even much that happens directly after the humble hosannas are shouted. Jesus goes into the temple, looks around, and leaves for the night. Part of me wants to think of Jesus making eyes at the temple authorities as if to say, I'm watching you, I'll be back tomorrow. But really, when we attend a parade or even a protest, we expect some kind of culmination of the moment, maybe a speech, maybe a ritual, maybe a march to the doors of the powers that be. Jesus' procession was fairly anticlimactic as far as that goes, but that was also the point. In Mark's gospel, Jesus comes into Jerusalem the week of Passover. This is a time when the normally 50,000 people of Jerusalem swelled to about 200,000. Also, the festival of Passover commemorates the liberation of the Israelites from slavery in Egypt. Rebellion is built into the fabric of the moment. You've heard me talk about the political and historical realities of Jesus' time and place. Jerusalem was essentially run by the religious authorities of the temple in collaboration with Rome. Herod was the puppet king propped up by Rome to oversee the Judeans. The temple and the Roman authorities had a vested interest in keeping the peace, especially in that time and place. There were often conflicts that arose in the spirit of the holiday. Ironically, the Jewish people were under the new regime of Rome. The Romans squeezed their livelihood and stole their land out from under them, and then made them pay off the debt by often working their own land. This is some of what Jesus railed against when he turned over the tables in the temple the next day in the Gospel of Mark. Though in this procession into Jerusalem, the plan is set ahead of time. Did you notice that? Jesus knew there would be a young colt tied to a post in the village. He knew there'd be a second parade happening on the other side of the city. When the time of Passover came each year, the Roman governor would ride into town from his place on the coast of Caesarea with a bombastic military parade. He would be atop the tallest horse possible, fully clad with armor and gold emblems of the Roman eagle. As the parade came through the streets, the locals would hear trumpets and armor. They'd see a military garrison, and they would bow and know their place or stare with resentful eyes, daring the men to come off their horses. The point of this parade was clear. It was meant to intimidate, to keep the peace through a show of force. This is the contrast that is set up as Jesus rides into town on the other side. Beloved of the people, or at least novel to them, Jesus' entrance was nothing like the bombastic Romans. Jesus riding in on a donkey nodded to the prophecy of Zechariah and signified he was coming in peace. Those who knew of and believed in the prophecies and promises of Scripture would look to Jesus as the Son of David, the Savior sent to liberate them from their daily oppression. The Lord would usher in a new kingdom of God. They even shouted, Hosanna, which means save us now. This makes me wonder, what were the crowds thinking and feeling as they watched Jesus awkwardly riding a donkey into town? A donkey who'd never had anyone on its back. Was that a smooth ride? I highly doubt it. I imagine some of you have ridden donkeys before and you could speak to that. The people may have felt joyful and excited to witness this counter parade. They may have felt hopeful and desperate, some lifting their faces up to Jesus as if they were seeing the sun for the first time, tears streaming down their faces in relief. Some probably felt as if they could taste the coming vindication, like the Romans wouldn't know what hit them. Who would suspect such power from one so humble and the opposite of flashy? I was trying to think of someone in our day we would drop everything and come out of our houses for to see riding along. A celebrity? a musician, a politician, someone whose writings inspire us? And yet I can't think of anyone else who would elicit such strong reactions from a crowd. What would it have been like to be there on that fateful day? I wonder if the people who laid down branches from the fields were simply laying down whatever they could find to show their reverence, to soften the muddy ground, to pave the way. Maybe they didn't have cloaks to lay down. Maybe they asked the same question as the little drummer boy in the Christmas song, "What can I give him?" I also learned in my research, people throwing their cloaks down can also be a callback to formerly blind Bartimaeus, whom Jesus healed on the way to Jerusalem. He threw off his cloak when he was healed, as if to say, "This is a new day." And then he followed Jesus as a disciple from there on out. So what does this all mean? Why focus on this entrance into Jerusalem today? Why not trace the story of the whole week, the passion of Christ in the Gospel of Mark? I think there's merit in allowing this moment to speak for itself, in placing ourselves in the shoes of the crowd that day, knowing that the story unfolded over the course of a week. I also believe we need the rise and fall of the week to take in the whole of Jesus' story for ourselves. I pray many of us will come back to hear Jesus' Last Supper this Thursday and sit with the pain of Good Friday before the glory of Easter Sunday. In dwelling on the palm processional today, we can wonder aloud, what would we do and say? What would we offer Jesus? Would we say, "Sure, go ahead and take my donkey, just bring it back by sundown"? It's like asking if you could borrow someone's car for the day. Would we be drawn to the short-lived following of Jesus on the way to the temple? Or would we wonder what's happening on the other side of town with the ones in power? When preparing for this day, the group helping plan throughout thought about assigning some people to be Roman soldiers and having them enter on the other side of the sanctuary in the procession. But it felt too visceral and a tad presumptuous. We realized none of us want to be associated with the oppressors of Jesus' time. We want to follow the path of peace and nonviolent resistance, even if we don't always understand it. Maybe for some people present in the holy city that day, the peaceful procession was a welcome change, a major shift in the wind, a seed planted that disrupted the thought, "This is just the way it is." Jesus offered a new way of seeing, of hoping, of believing. He announced the new kingdom of God coming into the world, one marked with peace and justice. On this day near the Passover in Jerusalem, Jesus speaks truth to power in his actions. He shows us an alternative reality that is possible in God's kingdom come when God's will is done. He shows us there is no other kingdom, no other ruler that has more power, authority, or wisdom than the one who sent him. We need to hear this counter-narrative today. Our minds, bodies, and souls crave this truth no matter what we're going through, no matter what's happening in the world. And there is way too much suffering and pain present near us, around us, and oceans away from us. God's way of peace, justice, and love will prevail. That is what Palm Sunday says. The Holy Spirit sent by Jesus all that time ago is with us and guiding us on the path Jesus laid out on Palm Sunday. What does it look like to follow Jesus' way today? To walk away from the glitz and glamour of the powerful and prestigious? To stand up for the voiceless and cry to God, "Hosanna! Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David." It looks like trusting God to build alternative visions for our families, our churches, our communities, our world. It looks like rejecting the devil and all the forces that defy God, the powers of this world that rebel against God, and the ways of sin that draw us from God. It looks like Jesus deliberately walking towards danger and destruction for our sake, dying and rising again to remind us that death does not and will never have the last word. So, dear church, two processions entered Jerusalem that day. One continues to end in death today. The other will always end in life everlasting. It's up to us to choose which parade we will follow. And that will make all the difference. Amen. We join together confessing our faith using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord.
trusting in God's promise to reconcile all things. Let us pray for the church, the well-being of creation, and a world in need. Blessed One, today the church sings glad hosannas as we enter Holy Week. Prepare us to bear witness to Christ's suffering and death endured for our sake. Gather your people around the cross and comfort us with resurrection hope. Hear us, O God. Renew your good creation and protect the balance of life on earth. Encourage the work of foresters, scientists, arborists, gardeners, and river keepers. We pray for the health of pollinating insects, songbirds, and native plants. Hear us, O God. Establish peace and justice among the nations. Hold to account any with authority to judge others. Grant that courts, legislatures, and local governments will serve with integrity and compassion. Hear us, O God. Bring hope to any who feel forsaken or forgotten. Make a way for refugees and asylum seekers. Reunite families enduring separation. We pray for any who are incarcerated, institutionalized, or in foster care, that they may know your love. We pray for all those on our hearts and minds we name aloud now or silently. Hear us, O God. Give energy and joy to our pastor, worship leaders, and musicians. Bless baptismal candidates, their sponsors, confirmands, and teachers. Watch over those who travel. Hear us, O God. Blessed One, our times are in your hand. Sustain us in discipleship throughout our lives and receive us into everlasting life. Hear us, O God.
Accompany us on our journey, God of grace, and receive the prayers of our hearts through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. Please share a sign of Christ's peace with one another as you're comfortable today.
Let us pray. Jesus, you are the bread of life and the host of this meal. Bless these gifts that we have gathered, that all people may know your goodness. Feed us not only with this holy food, but with hunger for justice and peace. We pray this in your name.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, whose suffering and death gave salvation to all. You gather your people around the tree of the cross, transforming the death into life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
You are indeed holy, almighty, and merciful God. You are most holy, and great is the majesty of your glory. You so love the world that you gave your only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish but have eternal life. We give you thanks for his coming into the world to fulfill for us your holy will and to accomplish all things for our salvation.
On the night you were betrayed, you took the bread. After giving thanks, you broke it and said, "This is my body, broken for you." And as you eat it, remember me. This is my body, broken for you. And as you eat it, remember me. On the night you were betrayed, you held the cup. After giving thanks, you lifted it up. This is my blood poured out for you. And as you drink it, remember me. So we thank you for the wine and for the bread. For we see the life you gave and the blood you shed. And we remember your wine.
your body, you shed your blood, and we remember. Oh. For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Remembering, therefore, his salutary command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to you, O Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we are able. We ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving with your word and Holy Spirit to bless us, your servants, and these, your own gifts of bread and wine, so that we and all who share in the body and blood of Christ may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be formed to live as your holy people and be given our inheritance with your saints. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory in your holy church now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Bread for the journey, a feast for hungry hearts. Come, all are welcome at the Lord's table. You may be seated.
Thank you.
body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Amen.
Let us pray. Generous God, at this table we have tasted your immeasurable grace. As grains of wheat are gathered into one bread, now make us one loaf to feed the world. In the name of Jesus, the bread of life.
Amen. Receive a blessing. Beloved, we are God's own people, holy, washed, renewed. God bless you and keep you, shower you with mercy, fill you with courage, and give you peace. Amen. We'll now have our sending song, Beneath the Cross of Jesus. It's found in your hymnal, ELW, the red hymnal, 338.
Go in peace, share your bread.